The Awakening by Kate Chopin. Chapter 24. Edna and her father had a warm and almost violent dispute upon the subject of her refusal to attend her sister's wedding. Mr. Pontellier declined to interfere, to interpose either his influence or his authority. He was following Dr. Mandelet's advice and letting her do as she liked. The colonel reproached his daughter for her lack of filial kindness and respect, her want of sisterly affection and womanly consideration. His arguments were labored and unconvincing. He doubted if Janet would accept any excuse, forgetting that Edna had offered none. He doubted if Janet would ever speak to her again, and he was sure Margaret would not. Edna was glad to be rid of her father when he finally took himself off with his wedding garments and his bridal gifts, with his padded shoulders, his Bible reading, his toddies, and his ponderous oaths. Mr. Pontellier followed him closely. He meant to stop at the wedding on his way to New York and endeavor by every means which money and love could devise to atone somewhat for Edna's incomprehensible action. "You're too lenient by far, Léonce," asserted the colonel. "Authority, coercion are what's needed. Put your foot down good and hard. The only way to manage a wife. Take my word for it." The colonel was perhaps unaware that he had coerced his own wife into her grave. Mr. Pontellier had a vague suspicion of it when he thought it needless to mention that late day. Edna was not so consciously gratified at her husband's leaving home as she had been over the departure of her father. As the day approached when he was to leave her for a comparatively long stay, she grew melting and affectionate, remembering his many acts of consideration and his repeated expressions of an ardent attachment. She was solicitous about his health and his welfare. She bustled around looking after his clothing, thinking about heavy underwear, quite as Madame Ratinau would have done with under similar circumstances. She cried when he went away, calling him her dear, a good friend, and she was quite certain that she would grow lonely before very long and go to join him in New York. But after all, radiant peace settled upon her when she at last found herself alone. Even the children were gone. Old Madame Pontellier had come herself and carried them off to Iberville with their quadroon. The old madame did not venture to say she was afraid they'd be neglected during Léonce's absence. She hardly ventured to think so, but she was hungry for them, even a little fierce in her attachment. She did not want them to be wholly children of the pavement, she always said when begging to have them for a space. She wished them to know the country, with its streams, its fields, its woods, its freedom, so delicious to the young. She wished them to taste something of their life their father had lived and known and loved when he too was a little child. When Edna was at last alone, she breathed a big, genuine sigh of relief. A feeling that was unfamiliar but very delicious came over her. She walked all through the house from one room to another, as if inspecting it for the first time. She tried the various chairs and lounges as if she'd never sat and reclined upon them before. And she perambulated around the outside of the house, investigating, looking to see if windows and shutters were secure and in order. The flowers were like new acquaintances. She approached them in a familiar spirit and made herself at home among them. The garden walks were damp, and Edna called to the maid to bring out her rubber sandals. And there she stayed, and stooped, digging around the plants, trimming and picking dead dry leaves. The children's little dog came out, interfering and getting in her way. She scolded him and laughed at him and played with him. The garden smelled so good and looked so pretty in the afternoon sunlight. Edna plucked all the bright flowers she could find and went into the house with them, she and the little dog. Even the kitchen assumed a sudden interesting character which she'd never before perceived. She went in to give directions to the cook, to say that the butcher would have to bring much less meat, that they would require only half their usual quantity of bread, of milk, and groceries. She told the cook that she herself would be greatly occupied during Mr. Pontellier's absence, and she begged her to take all the thought and responsibility of the larder upon her own shoulders. Well, that night Edna dined alone. The candelabra with a few candles in the center of the table gave all the light she needed. Outside the circle of light in which she sat, the large dining room looked solemn and shadowy. The cook, placed upon her mettle, served a delicious repast, a luscious tenderloin broiled à point. The wine tasted good. The marron glacé seemed to be just what she wanted. It was so pleasant, too, to dine in a comfortable peignoir. She thought a little sentimentally about Léonce and the children, and wondered what they were doing. As she gave a dainty scrap or two to the doggie, she talked intimately to him about Etienne and Raoul. He was beside himself with the astonishment and delight over these companionable advances, and showed his appreciation by his little quick snappy barks and a lively agitation. Then Edna sat in the library after dinner and read Emerson until she grew sleepy. She realized that she'd neglected her reading and determined to start anew upon a course of improving studies, now that her time was completely her own to do with as she liked. After a refreshing bath, Edna went to bed, and as she snuggled comfortably beneath the eiderdown, a sense of restfulness invaded her, such as she had not known before.